Please welcome Dr. Bud Frazier.
It's all right, sir.
That's all right.
Dr. Frazier, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
Dr. Frazier is a renowned heart surgeon who is chief of cardiopulmonary transplantation and director of surgical research at the Texas Heart Institute in Houston and chief of transplant services at St. Luke's Episcopal Hospital. During his career, Dr. Frazier has played a critical role in the development of many of the artificial hearts, pumps, and assist devices that have been transplanted over the years. Dr. Frazier, you were born in Stephenville and, as we heard, attended UT Austin, where you studied literature and the liberal arts and received a BA in history. You also contemplated law school. I've heard that in addition to your medical journals, on your bookcases are the writings of Plutarch and St. Augustine, William Faulkner, Leo Tolstoy. You once memorized Shakespeare's Hamlet, the story goes, just to see if it could be done. What made you change directions and choose a career in medicine?
Well, my parents were school teachers, and my mother was 40 years old when I was born, which is a bit unusual. So it was like growing up with grandparents. I was very spoiled. And I was sort of a Bible-battered Methodist. I had an uncle who was a Methodist preacher who, I remember he hit me one time with a Bible because it was a soft Bible, but I didn't know what who Jephthah, judge of Israel, was. And I really had no advice as to what I was going to do. I started out trying to play football, and that didn't work out. And I finally realized, you know, we couldn't just go on and on in school those days. We had to actually decide on doing something at some point. You know, I sort of
Remember those days fondly,
yeah,
right?
I envy some of the students today, but I decided, well, I wanted to do something that you didn't have to cheat, lie, or steal. Now, I'd been accepted to law school, and I don't mean this in any derogatory way.
With that setup, I can't wait to see where you go. Okay.
But I was 21 years old. Yeah. I had no real professional influence in my family, and so I decided. By the way, I really respect honest lawyers. They're the doctors of society, and so we depend on the good, honest lawyers, and there are many of them. It's an honorable calling. But saying that, I came to the conclusion, as a 21-year-old history major, that I could be a dentist, and I could teach school, or I could be a doctor. I never considered being a Methodist minister. That wasn't in there. But I decided I didn't want to really spend that much time in people's mouths. And I also, my parents were always grading papers. I was reading a lot of Chekhov then.
Yeah.
And Chekhov was a doctor, as many literary greats are doctors, as you know. And I was reading the doctor's stories. I said, well, that would be great to be a doctor. The problem was I was graduating from undergraduate school. I'd already been accepted to law school, and I
and there were prerequisite classes, right, that you had to take.
I had no prerequisites.
Yeah.
I was at home for the Easter vacation. We didn't have a spring break then, and I remember talking to my mother. She was in the kitchen. I was in the dining room. She was fixing breakfast. I said, Mother, I think I'll go to medical school. And she said, well, do whatever you want to do. I think you should just teach history and come back to this little school, but do whatever you want to do. But I don't think you'll make much of a doctor. And I said, why don't you think I'll make much of a doctor, Mother? She said, well, you know, you've never been able to kill anything. I didn't hunt. And I said, I don't think you have to kill things, Mother, to be a doctor.
I think it's actually the reverse.
And she said, well, I don't think you have to, but it would probably help. I realize sometimes in the middle of the night that she thought I was too soft-hearted.
Now, you really did this question, the prerequisite courses. You took all the prerequisite courses, deciding late. You took them all in a single year.
I took them all in a single year. You could do that at the University of Texas now. I'm sure it's totally impossible. Out of 170 undergraduate hours when I graduated, and we had 2 6-week semesters in the summer. And that fall, I took 33 semester hours. I took organic chemistry, quant, and comparative anatomy, and I started interviewing for medical
just
school.
Just like nothing, right? Just did
and,
it. Amazing.
I was accepted. I was accepted at Baylor.
Yeah.
On the weekend of July the 4th, I was interviewed at Baylor, the last place. I was accepted Southwestern and Galveston. But I wanted to go to Baylor. And I remember the weekend of the 4th, I came in, and the director of admissions asked me, well, I noticed you're a history major. Can you think of anything else that was celebrated on July the 4th other than the signing of the Declaration of Independence? And I said, well, you know, Adams and Jefferson both died 50 years later on July the 4th, 1826, which I think is what he wanted. And I said, you know, really the last day of the Battle of Gettysburg was July the 4th. Pickett's Charge was July the 3rd, but the last day was the 4th. And
yeah.
The Civil War was fought in America. And Vicksburg, Pemberton surrendered Vicksburg on July the 4th to get better terms from Grant. And I remember he just slammed my application shut and he said, if you want to go to medical school here, you can. Let's go out and enjoy the 4th. So that's one thing a history major might help you get into.
Be able to answer, right, exactly. Excellent. Now, you mentioned in passing you thought about playing football, but it didn't work out. I wanted to stay there for a second or come back to that. You were apparently a very good kicker in high school, kicker.
Yeah.
And Coach Royal created, when you were at UT, the first ever special teams kicking position just for you.
Well, he told me, I was a very good, particularly punter. We did extra points, but that was before the soccer-style kicking. They weren't quite as important. And the year before I was there, I was redshirted because I'd gone 1 year of junior college. And he'd lost a game to OU. Because of the kicking game. And of course, Darrell is a wonderful man. He could have been anything. I came to appreciate later, a good lawyer, a good doctor, a good Indian chief, anything. And but he was this attention to detail, the slightest detail. You know, Texas was never beaten badly when he was a coach. They would lose a game, but they were never beaten badly. And he told me that all I had to do was just stay and I would kick because he wanted to have a specialty kicker. And unfortunately, in spring training in 1960, I was kicking and a man named Tillman O'Brien. Tillman was the biggest player on the team at the time, and he sort of lumbered into me when I had my leg in the air. And actually, I heard my hamstrings pop.
Ooh.
And that ended my...
That was the end of your brief dalliance.
Yeah, that's right. And probably the best thing that ever happened.
Happens to the best of them. And in fact, it sent you off on a different path. Let's go to Baylor College of Medicine, as you referenced. You became a student, and you became, more importantly, heir to doctors Cooley and DeBakey, the titans of cardiac surgery we all know so well, who had made Houston the epicenter of cardiac science. You were assigned to a research project in the artificial heart lab of Dr. DeBakey and became one of his general surgery residents. Is that right?
I started working on the artificial heart when I was still a medical student.
Yeah.
Baylor had a wonderful program there. It was a small school, 75 small class students, and we had to write a research paper every year. And that I really learned more from that than anything else. And I sort of, by accident, got into the surgery program. And we were working on the total artificial heart, which Dr. Cooley ultimately implanted.
But Dr. DeBakey was very demanding, as I understand it.
Dr. DeBakey was, he had a little different teaching method.
Yeah.
I really learned a lot from him. And you would remember things from him, you know. For example, I remember asking him one day, one night in the middle of the night, I'd been up for two nights running, and you tried never to ask him questions. And I don't know why I asked him the question, but Mr. Kaplan's graft to his leg had clotted off, and his leg was white. And I did brought Dr. DeBakey to see him, he said, and I thought, I wonder why it keeps clotting off. And so I asked, and I was so tired, it just came out. You know, I knew never to ask him a question. I was the baking just scholar in my surgical class, and so I knew a lot about him. But I was just so tired, I just said out loud, I wonder why it keeps clotting off. He took me outside the room, and I knew that was bad. You know, that was... going to the woodshed.
Right.
And Dr. DeBakey would actually hit you. And And he said, you know, when blood stops moving, it clots. Is that too hard for your pea brain? And I said, yes, sir, I understand. Virchow's triad, principle of medicine, when blood stops moving, it clots. It's one of the triad. Now, do you understand that? And he hit me right in the chest. And I said, yes, sir. And then he said something I've never heard him say. He said, repeat after me, like in first grade, when blood stops moving, it clots. So I said, when blood stops moving, it clots. Well, I tell that story because it's interesting. Years later, we were working on the first approved device, and I was working in our lab, and they were about to give up on the device because when it filled, the graft that it filled through would clot off in the experimental animal. And after a few months, it would just totally occlude. They were going to give up on the project. But, of course, what was emblazoned in my brain was when blood stops moving, it clots.
It clots.
So I talked to the head of the project. I said, you know, we got to get rid of that long cannula and put the thing right in the heart. Because when blood stops moving, it clots.
It clots.
So he taught you in a way that would be memorable.
It is the thing that we will all take away from the Chancellor's Council meeting today. You mentioned Dr. Cooley, and of course we all know how legendary Dr. Cooley's work is. Graduate of UT Austin, the Denton Cooley Pavilion is right over there. By 1974, as I understand it, you saw that the most interesting heart device work at the Texas Heart Institute was with Dr. Cooley, who performed the first successful artificial heart transplant in the U.S. So give us the DeBakey versus Cooley, compare and contrast. Okay. How is Dr. Cooley different from Dr. DeBakey?
Well, Dr. Cooley was an artist, and he was, and anyone in the field will tell you he's the best technical cardiac surgeon that ever lived. He did things, there's not a pilot alive today could take that little plane hanging up in the Smithsonian and fly it across the Atlantic like Lindbergh did. There's not a surgeon alive today could do 12 or 14 open heart cases, difficult cases in a day, and then go to a ball game that night.
The way that he did.
It was just
the Lindbergh of heart surgery.
Just like silk.
Yeah.
And he was very calm, as his name suggests. Nothing could rattle him. And he never, when I knew him, by the time I started working, he started doing the first heart surgery in Texas in 1956. Mm. In fact, the first heart surgery in the U.S. outside of Minnesota of any meaningful attempts. And so by the time I was there in the mid-60s as a medical student, whatever problems he ran into, he knew immediately what
he had long ago.
Dr. DeBakey was much older. He was 12 years older, and he actually didn't do heart surgery until he was 52 years old. Mm. So he really, that wasn't his expertise.
Yeah.
But he was a great leader, and he's a great teacher.
Right.
And he did a lot to make Baylor Medical School one of the best medical schools in the world.
Now, let's talk about the artificial heart. There have been several stages in its evolution. Would you walk us through your quest to develop devices that could assist or replace the heart? I think we're going to put something up on the screen here.
Well,
shows the beatless heart pump.
Yeah, but of course the first thing we did was try to imitate the action of the heart. You know, just like the men trying to imitate the birds flying, we tried it in a pathway that worked, but it only worked temporarily.
Yeah.
If you remember it, well, I'm sure you don't, but because of medical students, I asked this question. How many times does your heart beat in 24 hours? Well, just do the math. If you're not doing anything, it beats 100,000 times every 24 hours. So 36, 38 million times a year in a sedentary person. So you're going to build a pump that has a membrane that's going to flex that often. Our first goal was to build one that would last 2 years. And we could build one that would last 2 years. But if it only lasts 2 years, you have to replace it every 2 years. That's no goal. And we really were not able to do anything with the pulsatile artificial heart other than use it as a life-saving device and ultimately as a bridge to transplant. We only have so many hearts to transplant, so that's not epidemiologically helping anything. And as I said, you know, counting on heart transplants to solve the problem of heart failure is like counting on the lottery to solve poverty. It just is an inconsequential number. life-saving for many patients and shouldn't be denigrated in any way. But we've got to do better.
Well, we know five million Americans suffer from some form of heart disease, but only about 2,000 hearts a year become available. It's exactly what you just said. The solution is the artificial heart. The heart, after all, is just a pump. We tend to think no beat, no pulse, no blood flow, the patient will die. But you and your colleague at the Heart Institute, Dr. Billy Cohn, have devised this beatless heart pump. What's unique about it? We're kind of short on time here, but say please, what is unique about the new pump, and why is it an amazing breakthrough?
It's a pulseless pump. Really, the only organ, if you think about it, that really needs a pulse is your heart itself. The other organs don't need a pulse, and when the blood reaches them, it's not pulsed. And I'd been working on this, again, since I was a medical student. I got the idea we don't need a pulse. Billy came down from Harvard. He'd been at Harvard for 10 years. Dr. Cooley used to say that one of the hardest things in life is to recover from a Harvard education. And he came down, and I showed him this work I'd been doing, and he explained 10 reasons why it absolutely couldn't work. And I said, well, let me take you down to our lab. You can tell that to this calf who's had one for 2 months without a beating heart. So I think we've worked on this, and we put it in 60 animals. Now we put it in patients. And the heart of the future that will replace the failed heart will be a pulseless or a continuous flow pump.
Amazing. Well, Dr. Frazier, everything we've heard today has been absolutely fantastic. Your story about the work that you did, we saw in the video, I thought was absolutely amazing. And I just want to thank you for everything you've contributed to our world and the hard work you've done. And thank you so much for being here today.
Well, I'd like to say finally, you know, particularly to the younger people, there aren't any younger people here, but there are a few.
There are a couple.
You should try to develop a passion and stick to your passion. And I've been fortunate enough to see this passion fulfilled, and I think most people, if they stick to their goals, they'll reach them.
Well,
thank
it's Dr. Frazier, it's an inspiration. Thank you so
thank
much.
You.
Appreciate it, sir. Thank you very much.